Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this presentation of English second language teaching for the diploma in pre-primary education. There are areas that I'm going to cover, but it's also very important that students acquaint themselves with the keywords of, you know, aspects of your course. Because at times, even in assignments, questions are asked and people don't even look at the keywords. They just go and find any other information that looks like it and, you know, give as answers. So it's very important that we look at the key concepts of our course and we use these whenever we are studying. The following are the areas that I'm going to cover in this presentation. The first one is the basic levels of language skills. It is important to appreciate that language is learned on different levels, and our learners need all these skills. So if we as teachers understand these levels, we are going to be able to teach the language well. Okay, the first one is phonology. Phonology is the study of the sound system of languages. It is also concerned with the anatomy and physiology, the organs of speech, and how we learn to use them. So in other words, this is how we pronounce the sounds of, you know, a language. We must be able to know that and whenever we speak, our you know, sound production organs are involved. That is the organs in our mouth, the tongue, you know, the teeth, the upper, you know, the upper part of the mouth, and so on. So when we articulate sounds, these organs are involved. So for each sound that we articulate, we should know where the position of our organs should be. So it's the sound and also the anatomy or physiology that are of the organs that are involved in producing these sounds. Then we have another one, morphology. Morphology studies the internal structure of words, how words are formed. You know, a morpheme is actually the smallest unit of a word. So how do we join these, you know, small units to form words? All right, you have seen, or in your course there are things like prefixes and so on. So those small words that, or small letters or groups of letters that we add to form words, actually that is what morphology deals with. The branch of that studies patterns of word formation within and across languages and attempts to formulate rules that model the knowledge of the speakers of those languages. For example, if you have words and you have to write plurals, there are those words that will take ES at the end, others just S. So those are the rules of morphology as well. Then we have syntax. Syntax means, you know, the joining together of words to form sentences. All right, so it's very important that after we have taught our children how words are formed and how words are pronounced, we also teach them how to join these words to make meaningful sentences. So if we understand the rules of syntax, the easier or the better for us to be able to teach it to children. And the last one, we also have semantics. Semantics is the study of how meaning is constructed or interpreted, clarified, obscured, illustrated, simplified, negotiated, or contradicted, or paraphrased. So in other words, this is the study of the meaning of words, the meaning of sentences, even paragraphs or whatever discourse that we are talking about. So it's mainly about meaning when we talk about semantics. So if they can join words together to form sentences, these sentences must be meaningful and they should be able to, you know, get the meaning from, for example, what is being said to them or what is written, and they should also be able to make meaning when they talk, because that is the reason why we produce sounds and so on. Otherwise, if we just you know, put meaningless words together, then we are not achieving the, you know, the purpose of language. Then we have pragmatics. Pragmatics is another level that is a little bit difficult to understand. But whenever you use language, there are certain contexts, there are situations that we use language. The type of language or the understanding that a friend, a very close friend, can, you know, make out of words that you use every day. Sometimes the words that you use with your close friends may not mean what we know in general. That if you just write the word there, we may not be able to get the meaning of that word. But if you say it to a friend will, you know, take for example the word love. A stranger will tell you they love you. You've got a certain perception of the type of love that they are talking about. They may just be lying or so on. But if somebody that you know really loves you and they use the word love, there are a lot of, you know, connotations that are attached to that word love, because you know how much they feel for you or about you. So people use language within a context and in real life situations. So if you look at semantics, it's just the fixed, you know, the fixed meaning of words. For example, if the meaning of a word as you would find it in the dictionary. But, you know, factors such as time, place, and the social relationship between speaker and hearer affect the ways in which language is used to perform different functions. So what he said, you know, if you Rush Hour, think about the movie Rush Hour, those that have seen it, you've got the word nigger used there. If the word nigger is used black on black, there is no offense. But once a white person uses the word nigger on a black person, it becomes very offensive. So it depends on who is saying it and what time this is being said. So that is the level of language that we call pragmatics. So it depends, language depends on situation, it depends on the time, on the context, on the relationship between the people that are engaged in the discourse. Then we also need to understand as teachers that we have factors that can influence language development in children. We are dealing with children at pre-primary, and we are very much concerned with how their language develops. So we need to be aware of factors that, you know, affect or influence their language development. And these factors are social factors, cognitive factors, that has to do with the brain, how they process language, the social, the environment, their surrounding, the people around them, how they interact with the people around them. Linguistic would be, you know, what they know about the language or the words that they already know. Conceptual, how they develop concepts of language and how they perceive language. So we are going to look at each one of these in detail. Social factors, these would be you know, the social environment that the language the child is exposed to. This contains of interaction. So if you interact with the child, then obviously the chances of his language skills developing quickly is high. We've got the verbal environment, verbal, that is the interaction in terms of speech. You know, how often you speak to a child, how much do they hear of, you know, the language. It is imperative to not only speak to your child, but also maintain conversation when your child is around. Sometimes we just get, you know, involved in speech with children only by asking them, you know, yes or no answers. But it is recommended that we engage them. We engage into language exchange with them, you know, ask them things that require them to explain to us certain things, to express their feelings about things that they've encountered maybe at school or how they feel about, you know, their home, their parents, and so on, so that they are involved in lengthy discussions. So it's important that there is conversation and not just, you know, ordinary speaking. The levels of income and, you know, television, for example, also affects language development. It's not advisable to only, you know, have our children have input from, you know, television only. Those, we also know that, that those parents that spend so much time away also don't have time to engage their children in conversations. So maybe if we understand these factors as teachers, then we will know how to fill the void. When the social environment of the home is centered on watching television, language and verbal expression decrease, because you, everybody is just sitting there watching the television. There's no exchange in terms of words. There's nothing like help telling a child to express themselves about how they feel about school, what they've learned, any new things that they've seen about their friends, and so on. So this is what builds the language repertoire of a child, because this child, you know, interacts with this immediate environment, not the TV. The TV is about, you know, things that may be removed from us. Then we have cognitive process. This is the way how a child processes language. So it depends on things like how often your child hears you speak. Okay, if they don't hear any language or they don't have any language input, then obviously they will not have anything to process in their minds. Children who are exposed to an unusually high proportion of examples of language form learn at a faster rate than those who are not. So if they are engaged in, if they hear, you know, language on a daily basis, they are spoken to, you know, people around them talk to them, ask them to also respond, that will help them to, you know, learn the language faster. Then we have linguistic. Your child's linguistic ability directly influences his language development. Children are likely to associate a new word with a current object they do not have, a label or word to associate with it. For example, if a new word is you know, said, for example, there is a group of things and you ask a child to bring one item from it, and they realize that they know all those objects there, but there is only one that they do not know. So they are, even if this word is new, they are going to associate with it with the object that they do not know. They also look at verb endings, for example. Young children would always associate endings with ing to infer meaning for, you know, processes, things that are continuing, for example, swimming, playing, running. So they've got that ability to process language like that, to associate ing forms with processes or things that are not yet finished. Then conceptual and perceptual. Conceptually speaking, language skills are related to word knowledge. If your child has difficulty recalling a word, then that means they do not know the object that that word denotes. So it's about the concepts, the number of concepts that they know. If they can remember it, that means they know the object that is associated with. If they cannot, for example, the word dog, if a child has seen a dog, constantly sees a dog, there's no way they are going to forget the word dog. But if they forget it, that means they do not know the object that it labels. In perceptual terms, your child's auditory perceptual skills at 6 to 12 months is a predictor of their vocabulary size and syntactic complexity at 23 months. So if they can, you know, they can perceive sounds, that means that that can show that at, you know, 23 months, they will be able to have a certain vocabulary size. Cognitive domain and language learning. We've got different domains of development, social, cognitive. So, but if you look at cognitive, it has a lot to do with language learning. The relationship would be that if a child, cannot process, for example, process thoughts, then they will not be able to use a language. They will not be able to learn a language. If they cannot hold any attention to something, they cannot attend or listen to something, then obviously they cannot learn a language. Cognitive domain also helps them to remember events, because you can only remember in your mind. Understand the environment around them, they process thoughts, they look at what is there, they perceive, and then they have the ability to plan, predict, regulate and evaluate any given task or situation experienced in a language classroom. So cognitive domain is very important in language learning. Then the other area is the perspective of theories or theories of language development. As teachers, we need to understand how language develops, or different theories that are associated with language development among our children. These, what will follow, are different views of language development, and the perspectives that, perspectives will be the theories or the ways in which people believe children acquire language. There are different types of them, so it depends on which one or which perspective you look language development from. The first one is behaviorist perspective of language development. Then we have the nativist perspective of language development. We have the constructivist approach to language development, and the interactionist perspective of language development. Let's unpack each one of them. The first one is the behaviorist perspective of language development. You can already see the word behavior is in there. This perspective is based on the fact that, or the belief that, infants learn oral language from other human role models through a process involving imitation, rewards, and practice. So it's behavior that we adopt or we acquire. So we can also look at language behavior. So in other words, what this perspective believes is that when children hear us speak, they imitate, and that is how they learn language, by just imitating. And this process is reinforced or aided by the fact that when they imitate, when a child, for example, imitate us, we get excited. You know, we appreciate the fact that they are learning these words, and we reward them. And when we reward them, they keep on practicing. So they feel motivated and they do more. They learn more words, we reward, then they get motivated again, and we say something, they imitate us, they get rewarded, they imitate, they get rewarded, and that encourages them to practice and practice even more. So this is the basis of this perspective. Human role models in infants' environment provide the stimuli. Stimuli is the motivation for them to learn. So we give them input, because we keep on saying things, they also imitate us, they hear us and they imitate, and then we reward them. So the whole thing is that there should be stimuli, there should be input, and there should be rewards. When a child attempts oral language or imitates the sounds of speech patterns, they are usually praised and given affection for their efforts. Praise and affection are the rewards. So it's not that we give them money, but because we feel happy, we approve, we praise them, we clap our hands, to show that we really like what they've just done. Those are the rewards that we give the children. But then there are questions about this perspective. Critics of this perspective say, what about situations where you have children that grow up in environments where praise and affection are absent? If this is the way that children learn a language or develop language, would they not just stop then, because they are not praised and they are not given affection? What about abstract words that they do not you know, pick from the immediate environment? How do they learn them? And also that they are evidence of novel forms of language not modeled by others. There are children that, you know, are so intelligent that sometimes they come up with novel forms or new forms of language that, you know, you can't find in their environment. And at times, children in different places acquire language uniformly, like in the same manner, or they acquire same language patterns. So how do you account for these if each child is, you know, exposed to a certain environment, to a certain language patterns, and they can only imitate those? So these are the challenges that people have put forward against the behavioralist perspective of language development. So if you discuss a behavioralist perspective of language development, for example, you must also look at the criticism of this perspective. The second one is the nativist perspective of language development. Nativist perspective argues that humans are biologically programmed to gain knowledge. All right, so we've got an innate ability to acquire knowledge. And part of this knowledge is language. The main theorist associated with this perspective is Noam Chomsky. Chomsky proposed that all humans have a language acquisition device that contains knowledge of grammatical rules common to all languages. So each one of us is born with this device. He would love to think of it as if it's just, you know, a device that is inserted perhaps in our brains, and that whenever we are exposed to a language, or it contains the rules that whenever we are exposed to any language, we then take in our rules of language and apply them to that language. So it's easy for us to learn each language, even its own rules. It also allows children to understand the rules of whatever language they are listening to. Then Chomsky also developed the concept transformational grammar, surface structure, and deep structure. Transformational grammar is grammar that transforms a sentence. For example, a sentence can take different subjects. For example, if you say the boy goes to school, you can replace the boy with the man, the woman, the girl, and so on, and still, for, you know, the other parts still remain similar in meaning. Then surface structure are words that are actually written, the language on the surface. If we say the words or we write the word down, that is the surface structure. But then there are underlying meanings of such a word, and we call that the deep structure. The constructivist approach of language development: knowledge isn't a thing. This approach is based on the fact that knowledge is not a thing that can be simply given by the teacher at the front of the room to students in their desks. Knowledge is constructed by learners through an active mental process of development. Learners are the builders and creators of meaning and knowledge. So in other words, if you expose the children to language, they can then learn the language themselves. So it's through exposure, through teaching, but not being spoon-fed, through discovery and so on. This draws from four principles. The first principle is that learning depends on what we already know. So we need to build on what the children already know. Then new ideas occur as we adapt and change our old ideas. So if it depends on what we already know, we can use what we already know to learn new things. Learning involves inventing ideas rather than mechanically accumulating facts. So we're not going to, it's not just a matter of saying this is how it is, but rather discover something. And then if you can discover something, you'll be able to say this is how it is because of this and this. Meaningful learning occurs through rethinking old ideas and coming to new conclusions about new ideas which conflict with our old ideas. Then a productive constructivist classroom then consists of learner-centered, active instruction. The teacher provides students with experiences that allow them to hypothesize, predict, manipulate objects, pose questions, research, investigate, imagine, and invent. The teacher's role is to facilitate the process. Learning occurs by an active construction of meaning rather than by passive recipients. So let them interact with language patterns. Let them come up with new forms in your class. Don't just give them to them as if they are just supposed to parrot them. The constructivist approach of language development, again, continued. Here, the teacher explains that when we as learners encounter this approach explains that when learners encounter an experience or a situation that conflicts with our current way of thinking, a state of disequilibrium or imbalance is created. So what does that mean? It raises questions. If this is what, you know, this is not what I know, it does not fit in with what I know, then what is it? How do I account for it? So there the journey begins. We must then out our thinking to restore equilibrium or balance. To do this, we make sense of the new information by associating it with what we already know, that is, by attempting to assimilate it into our existing knowledge. When we are unable to do this, we accommodate the new information to our old way of thinking by restructuring our present knowledge to a higher level of thinking. Then we have the interactionist perspective of language development. Interactionists argue that language development is both biological and social. Interactionists, from the word to interact, argue that language learning is influenced by the desire of children to communicate with others. And the interactionists argue that children are born with a powerful brain that matures slowly and predisposes them to acquire new understanding that they are motivated to share with others. So, a powerful brain and also desire to interact with others. Then we are going to look at the concepts phonetics and phonology, or key concepts in phonetics and phonology. Phonetics is the production and perception of speech sounds as physical entities. It's also as it's pronounced by bringing the lower lip into, for example, V, the letter V, in contact with upper teeth, and forcing air out of the mouth while the vocal folds vibrate and nasal cavity is closed off. So, for example, that is what we call phonetics, the production or perception of speech sounds. Phonology is the sound patterns, the sound system of a particular language. So you can speak about the phonology of the English language, but phonetics is the production of sound. In English, a word never starts with KN, for example, that is the sound. Not that the word knife starts with N and not K. All right, so there's no combination of the sound K and N. Otherwise, where you find them, they will be, a K will be silent. All right. While in other languages, or for example, in German, it's possible to have a K and N pronounced at the same time. So phonology is the sound system of a language, or the sound patterns of a language. Then we have concepts like the vowel. Vowel, a speech sound made by allowing breath to flow out of the mouth without closing any part of the mouth or throat. Look at the words there is no closure of any, and there is no closure of any part of your mouth. Whereas a consonant is a speech sound made by partially or completely blocking the flow of air through the mouth using the lips, teeth, or the tongue or the palate. For example, if we say the word k, there will be some kind of partial closure. T or D, there is partial closure and the teeth are brought together. So that is a consonant. Difference between consonants and vowel, the other one is free flow of of air from the out of the mouth, and where is the other one? There is partial blockage or complete blockage of the flow of air. Of course, there are only five vowels in the English language, and then the rest of the letters of the alphabet. Sometimes Y is also considered a vowel, but the rest of the letters of the alphabet are actually consonants. Then we have the nouns. Nouns are also very important for us teachers of English. We normally, in general, they are referred to as the naming words. They name different things. They could be classified in different categories. We've got proper nouns. Proper nouns are names of places, specific names of places or people, usually written with a capital, initial letter. Then we have common nouns, general names of things, for example, chair, city, person. But if we refer to a specific city, Windhoek, then we are using a proper noun. Abstract nouns are those, things that we cannot touch, as in qualities, feelings, beauty, jealousy, manners, we cannot touch those. So they are abstract nouns as opposed to concrete. Collective nouns, it's when we refer to things in their groups. There are those things that would always move in groups. For example, bees would move in a group. So it's a swarm. The cattle graze together. We call it a herd of cattle, and so on and so on. So acquaint yourself with different plural forms of nouns also. That is very, very important. The verbs. Verbs denote action instead of being. Verb types. It's very important to learn about verb types and their functions, how they are used. For example, helping verbs are those verbs that are used with ing forms. He is swimming. So the verb is actually a helping verb in the main verb is swimming. Being verbs are verbs like is, are, and then we have regular verbs, and then the linking verbs. So it's very important that you look at these in your study guides and understand the differences between all of them. We also teach our children through storytelling. But it's useless to just tell a story without deriving activities from the story, because otherwise the children will just listen to the story and that's the end of it. But if we say we are going to maybe listen to a story about this and this, what do you know about it? And after reading, we also have follow-up activities that will make it a learning experience. All right, so there are activities that we can use as pre, before reading the story, and after reading the story. For example, if you are to tell a story, first of all, you can look for the prior knowledge of learners on the story. You can ask them about what they know about the subject of the story. You can show and discuss an object from the story. For example, if there is maybe a storm being told, you can show the destructive ways of storms or pictures that denote destructive ways of storms and ask them to discuss that. Or maybe there is a story about man and his best friend, the dog. So you can bring a picture of the dog to class and ask them about what they know about a dog, or how do they consider, how do they feel about dogs, owning dogs, and so on. Picture of an important character in the story. It could be somebody that maybe they have heard of. Then you bring a picture and they discuss about the picture. And you also look at important words in the story, those words that carry the story with them. The meaning of the words, do they have the heard of the words before? What do they mean? You can look up the meaning with the children, so that it's easier for them to understand the story when it's told. Then after reading the story, you can ask them about whether they've had similar experiences like the ones experienced in the story. You know, you can ask them to draw a picture of an important character in the story, or ask them to tell a story from the story from a different point of view. Have parts of the story with maybe important words in, then you ask them to fill in the missing words, or you can ask them to devise a dialogue between characters, or make a drama out of a story, or write a letter from one character to another, you know, maybe bringing out the subject of the story. Then we have teaching aids, newspapers as teaching aids. These are very important because they are easily available, so they can be used for any of the core classes. They can be used to teach about people, places, and things. We spoke about nouns here already, so if you speak about people, places, and things, you are talking about nouns. They can be used to teach math activities such as clipping coupons and basic math. They can be used to teach parts of speech. They can be used to introduce to teach about the newspaper itself, a variety of features in the newspaper, and you know, the fact that learners can now be introduced to a newspaper is an exciting resource where they can get certain things from, sometimes civic education from it. And you know, it's important that as they grow, they acquire skills to become, you know, intelligent newspaper readers. Worksheets, these are very important. We design them, or we can find them already designed from books, from the internet, and so on. Handouts completed to practice skills. If we teach, for example, maybe a story, we can have a handout, like we said, that we can use we can ask them to fill blank spaces. So that can be done through handout. It's important that you know, if a teacher is too busy or wants the students to repeat a certain skill, they can also use worksheets, so that they can attend to those that need attention while the others are busy to complete worksheets. Homework, they can be used as homeworks or assignments, and these performance in worksheets can also be used to test or to assess the progress of the children. Chalkboard, this is the, you know, the traditional, you know, teaching aid that is available in all our classrooms. It can be found used everywhere. You don't need electricity for this. New technologies have not eliminated it. That is why you still find it even in very modern classes, next to a smart board. You would still find a chalkboard there. It has tremendous value in all kinds of teaching. Every teacher finds it effective, so everybody will be able to use this teaching aid. It permits contrast. You can use different colors, you know, in order for you to underscore certain things that you want to. Can be used to enumerate the most important points of the lesson. You can draw flowcharts or illustrations or solve problems in math. Different colors can be used for contrast and interest. If there's one part that you want your children to really pay attention to, you write it in a bright color. Neat arrangement of chalkboard material can increase memory. It is an unequaled teaching aid because it can be used everywhere. It beats all the other teaching aids. Teacher presents verbally and puts down the main points on the board. Most obvious teaching aid, but is often not used to full potential. And then we also need our children, because they are learning a language, and speaking is one of the skills that we need to develop. It's very important that we get them to speak with confidence. If they can't speak in confidence, they can't practice. All right. How do we get them to speak with confidence? The first way is to play word games with them. If you play word games with them, you are increasing their vocabulary, so they will be comfortable to use these words when they speak. Encourage the student to attend book talks or book discussions. If there are places where they can be, you know, where books are being discussed, story books, for example, let them go there and also hear about what people say about these books. Maybe they will also have, you know, a way to generate ideas that they can share with others. Listen to your child and make him feel important about what he is speaking about. If you approve what they are speaking and you show that you can listen to them, they will be encouraged to speak. In order to teach a child to speak with confidence, he must know that what he says is heartfelt to important adults in his life. So if a teacher can listen to me, for example, if my father can listen to me, if my mother can listen to me, then what I'm saying is important. So I should keep on saying it. This is how the children feel. Read with a child and have her predict different outcomes to the story. These stories, like we've said, story activities are very, very important, like prediction or discussing characters and so on. Bring the child to various lectures about something he's interested in, and then teaching pronunciation, also very important. We can use different ways of teaching pronunciation. Some of these are minimal pairs. If we say minimal pairs, we mean we are limiting the sound that we want our children to learn to only two, that is the pairs. Pronunciation of just one sound, but this one sound should be in two words that are related. Just, that they should vary in only one sound. For example, the word pet and cat only differ in the P and the C. Otherwise, the et is pronounced similarly. So if we are pronouncing, if we want to focus on the word et, then we can use this pair in order to drill the sound et with our children. Then we can go on and on and on, pick certain pairs that we can use to teach them pronunciation. That is called minimal pairs. This method helps with pronunciation by focusing on one sound, but it also expands vocabulary. Then isolation. Isolation only means it's not about isolating the child. I've seen in assignments and exams before, students are talking about isolating the child. No, it's isolating the sound that you want the child to learn. Isolate a specific sound, pronounce the sound repeatedly. People say it with you repeatedly, so they repeat after you. Focus on small nuances in the correct spelling and ingraining the sound pattern in their minds. All right, it is helpful for struggling learners. If you find that, for example, you've used the minimal pairs and the children still struggle with the sound, isolate it, and then you can drill it home. Then we've got assessment. Assessment is very, very important, but we should know how we assess, because if we are harsh with our assessment at pre-primary, then some of our children may get discouraged and, you know, hate school. Assessment is the process of collecting, analyzing, and recording information about student progress towards achievement of syllabus outcomes. We've got syllabus outcomes, we've got the child. So what the information that we collect from the child, we use it and measure it against the syllabus outcomes. Then we can place the child in terms of the continuum of learning. How far is he from achieving the syllabus outcomes? How do we do this at pre-primary? We observe when helping with activities. So we observe our children. We don't necessarily have to make them write an assessment task. When we are marking people's exercises, for example, the handouts that we've given them to work at home, when we mark, we also see if it's out of 10, do they score 5 out of 10, more than 5, or they cannot score anything at all. Then these records that we collect is used for the following. We keep the record of their performance, and we can use that for our own information in school administration, all parents. And when we are recording this information, the children should not know that we are recording the information. So that is the nature of assessment at pre-primary. And that is the end of my presentation for today. Wishing you all the best, and please stay in touch if there are questions that have, you know, this presentation aroused.